Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. Please come to order. We're going to begin the public statement hearing now. All right, Howard. Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I call case 14F0490, application of Cassadaga Wind, LLC, for a certificate of environmental compatibility and public need pursuant to Article 10 to construct a 126-megawatt wind energy project. My name is Kevin Casuto. I'm an administrative law judge with the Department of Public Service. And to my left is Dakin Lee Cakes, another administrative law judge with DPS. And at the end of the table is Judge Nicholas Garlick of the DEC, another administrative law judge. We're all presiding in this matter. This phase of the hearing is being recorded. A transcript will be produced that will be available on the Citing Board website and the Department of Public Service website. All right, so the first speaker tonight is Tina Graziano. Please come forward to the podium. And following Ms. Graziano, we will hear from Earl Riggle. Mr. Riggle should come forward and please be seated in the chair. Good evening.
Good evening, thank you. I'm here to represent my family and friends. Let me start off by saying something similar I said at a Villanova public hearing. The residents of the townships of Cassadaga Wind should request another hearing. Due to the fact that every resident has not been formally notified via postal mail. There are many residents who still have no idea of this project and certainly no idea of this hearing. So when your board and the wind company claim transparency, don't fall for it. The same thing happened in Villanova. All residents were never notified by postal mail, and not everyone buys a newspaper, but everyone receives mail. This is what divides communities. Secrets that are hiding a forever lifestyle change. When I say they, I'm referring to the wind company, town board, and lawyer. Did they tell you your wind lawyer, who was supposed to be protecting you, is paid for by the wind company? Did they tell you your largest financial asset, your rural property, will now be listed as part of an industrial wind farm? Think about that when working on your for sale sign. Property values will be going down. Did they tell you and show you a visual of the proposed 123 wind turbines that will be in our connecting townships? All of them are about 37 feet shorter than the tallest building in Buffalo. Monstrous. Think of the visual impact on the people who vacation and camp in this area. This will definitely have a serious impact on their decisions to frequent this area. Another financial impact. Did they tell you there is new technology of bladeless turbines coming out on the market in 2020? Did they tell you our eagles, hawks, herons, geese, songbirds, hummingbirds, and our much needed bats are just considered collateral damage? Nothing on these turbines will repel or warn them. The tips of the blades are usually clocked at 180 miles per hour. The very things we love and enjoy will be executed daily. Did they tell you your TV antenna will now be worthless, too much interference? Did they tell you these turbines aren't really green or saving the earth? It's all about economics. They did tell me that. Did they tell you about the negative health risks, the proven risks associated with these turbines, the infrasound they produce, wind turbine syndrome, sleep deprivation? This should always be at the top of your list. A conversation with Mark Lyons, a Red spokesman for the Ball Hill Wind. I asked the problem of shadow flicker, and he said, we pay well for shadow flicker. Are they paying you to ignore your health risks too? Money will not ensure yourself, your families, and your neighbors' good health. The landowners who signed lease agreements should have done their research and not have listened to the traveling salesman selling a dangerous product. Europe, Ireland, Australia, and even the United States are now listening to the documented, proven negative health impacts these turbines are having on humans and animals. We need to take heed of these warnings and protect ourselves. Too many negative issues with health, property value, and bird and bat kill. This turbine project needs to be stopped until further testing can deem them safe for all. Thank you.
Next, we'll hear from Mr. Riggle, following Mr. Riggle and Angelo Graziano. Please speak into the microphone.
I'm Earl Riggle. I've been looking at the EverPower Cassadaga Wind pre-construction noise impact assessment. I've been looking at it online at the website. It was done by IRSG. The predicted noise levels for the summer nighttime for many of the nearby residences, 75 are over the standards for the Department of Environmental Conservation. They said that they're going to meet the 45, but the standard now, I believe, is 40. And many of them are over five, over the, you know, they're over 45, they're well over five, over the 40. And even more over the world, the limit set by the World Health Organization for nighttime noise of 40. And even those levels are only achieved with almost half of the turbines, 23 of them, using a noise reduction operation, NRO. And these should be reserved measures for occasional isolated noise events, not part of the original design. In testimony provided before the Wisconsin Public Service Commission in reference to the Highland Wind Farm proposal, acoustician Paul Schomer, when asked, to your knowledge, has a wind farm ever been designed with a curtailment strategy in the United States? His answer was no. Wind turbines and wind farms are designed to operate at maximum capacity. It makes little sense to invest in larger turbines and then reduce power output to comply with noise limit regulations. Relying on untested software to predict when noise limits are being exceeded for a particular residence within a large wind farm and expecting that software will successfully reduce noise levels to a maximum limit for each and every affected residence is ludicrous. When asked, is Highland's curtailment mitigation strategy in the public interest? He answered, no, absolutely not. To permit this wind farm with mitigation is a principal means of protecting the public would not be in the public interest. In another part of their documents submitted by EverPower, RSG, who did the sound study, noted we had higher wind shear than any other project they'd ever worked on. This condition is a major contributor to amplitude modulation and increased noise annoyance. Also of great concern is a shadow flicker report prepared by Environmental Design and Research. It identifies 55 receptors with 30 hours or more shadow flicker a year. 23 of those are non-participating and getting 30 to 70 hours, and 32 participators will get 30 to 116 hours. Ohio Siting Board won't certify a project with over 30 hours, and New Hampshire only allows 8 hours. I ask, are we less worthy of protection? To me, this is obviously a poorly designed turbine layout from a public safety standpoint, and that will cause undue annoyance, sleep deprivation, and subsequent adverse health effects if allowed to be built. This is exactly why physicians, acousticians, other experts in wind experienced countries are calling for safer setbacks of 1.5 to 2+ miles, much lower noise limits of 35 to 40 dBA, or even complete moratoriums until safe setbacks can be determined by long overdue unbiased health studies and research. Please likewise use the precautionary principle and reject this project. Thank you.
Thank you. The next speaker is Angelo Graziano, following Mr. Graziano, Joni Riggle.
Hi, I'm Angelo Graziano. I'm a Town Villanova councilman. I've been involved with the Ball Hill Wind Project. I'm here because I have family and friends in this township, and I would like to inform them about the issues that come with this wind project. Just the fact that no one has opposed to the project and everybody in the townships have been informed is a blatant lie. If the people in all the townships across New York could vote on these projects, none would be started. I myself have asked the residents owners of Ball Hill Project to notify the entire residents of Villanova by postal mailers. 3 separate times it has never happened. To this day, all the residents don't know of our project. This is happening right here. All the residents of your township have not been informed. I also asked our wind company for finished projects and research No answer. I asked about oil leakage, no answer. I asked about decreased property values, no answer. Our project was under a seeker, not Article 10. Your project will be done, will not be done fairly. Health issues, setbacks are too close, wind turbine syndrome, infrasound, noise limits, burned back hills, and falling property values are all proven facts and problems. You are being represented by a lawyer who is paid by the wind farm. Conflict to your interest? How much money is your health, your family's health, your home value, and the environment around you worth? Force them to notify everyone and inform you the facts. Now, I got a letter here that was written to a woman that's on the World Health Organization, and they're doing environmental noise guidelines for the European region. And it might answer a lot of the questions that some of the people ask when they hear this letter. It says, "Dear Madam, I live in Poiseau, France, 11 kilometers eastern of the Haute de Cauche, 11 kilometers, about 6 miles away. The Dampierre wind farm is located two plateaus higher than my village. It was built in 2010, and as soon as we leave Cirque Valley, you can see the wind turbines. There are 14 of them, 145 meters. That's 475 feet tall. Two megawatt turbines. There's 11 northern, six turbines, 125 meters, which is 410 foot tall. The main problems appear after the construction of the wind farm. Vibrations in my house and the whole valley, they are probably bound to infrastructure. When the wind comes from the west, there's furthermore an aerial noise. The walls of my house vibrate as if a compressor was against the wall. So there is continuous buzz that generates tiredness and possibility to get concentrated on electrical work. Sleep difficulties, nights waking, nightmares, thorax suppression, nausea, upper limb and head jumps, as if I had to protect myself from aggression, headache, eye tiredness, nervousness, erosion. I don't look well, dizzy spell, need to flee far away. Sometimes the noise is so loud that it wakes me up. Some days I can do nothing. As my sons, both students are at home, they fall sick and they don't have any sleep anymore. One of them says it's a strange acoustical atmosphere. He's a musician, they don't hear the vibrations, but they feel them in another way. We can feel it in the whole house, a room under the roof as it hit, and I can't stand it anymore when the house vibrates too much. My dog doesn't want to stay inside. It goes out in the middle of the night or wants to stay outside and go, even when it's raining. Recently, a friend visited me for 2 hours. The second hour, she said her head was starting to spin. I looked at the weather forecast. There was no wind. In the first hour, the western wind started blowing, and the second, another friend clearly heard the noise. The vibrations here are since several years. I've estimated about six. Thanks to my familiar remarks, I only recently understood they came from the wind farm. By reading articles about wind turbine infrastructure, I live in a quiet, calm village with 70 inhabitants. I had fruitless search for the noise source in my street, thinking that maybe it's a heat pump because of the typical blade noise. When the whole village and the farms, I shut my electricity meter off. There is no bordering house. The noise is everywhere. Even in the valley, this is like a Renaissance chamber, but it seems to come from nowhere. Since then, I have made observations. Thanks to them, I could notice the vibrations are bound to the wind direction and the force. I went to the road directly under the wind farm and not exactly recognized the vibration. I could hear it, the same signature of two friends living 7 kilometers from the turbine, seeing them in their houses, one northern, one western. The second one suffers from nausea and sleep troubles since some years. She doesn't know where it comes from. She is almost never more at her home. I can also hear it in all the valleys in the region. And when I go in other places, I don't hear it anymore. I sleep very well. By the Easter wind, the problems are relieved by a ground buzz. No nausea, no jolts. Concentrated, no visual problems. I can usually read without glasses when the lull lasts several days. I come alive again. During long periods without wind, I can read 40 pages of hard philosophy book to go. When the wind approaches the west, I can't even read two. The ground vibrations are present everywhere the wind comes from. They arrive one day and the wind starts to go away, and one day it finishes blowing. What means they are most always present, except in long periods of wind. The western wind adds noisy sound. It's worse than health, nausea, jumps, eye problems, main concentration problems are directly bound to it. By particularly strong wind, as if a helicopter would approach but never arrive, even during hurricanes, while turbines are certainly stopped, 42 winds whistle even though they don't move. It's a real trouble for my everyday life. For my professional life, I am a researcher and author and almost have to work at home. And also for my health, for example, was unable to translate those pages in the last days because of the wind. I also have heard about the strong health problem next to all the wind farms in the area. 66 turbines can be seen from the plateau above the village. More than 150 are in a project within 10 kilometers of my house, 19 directly over our roof. All the winds would be poisoned. Sincerely yours. And that's just one woman. So you know that these people that are deciding these freaking on this panel set these guidelines, they're all for real. They're just not all here yet. They're going to be here. So thank you very much.
Thank you. The next speaker is Joni Riggle. Following Ms. Riggle, Edwin Hill Jr.
I just want to say that I hold no animosity.
Ms. Riggle, please speak into the microphone so everybody can hear.
I just wanted to say we live in a small community and it's been very difficult navigating through this. I hold no animosity towards the good, hardworking land leasers and farmers hosting wind turbines. I believe they were given the typical win-win only sales pitch and not the full story of likely impacts on family and neighbors due to these insufficient setbacks and noise limits. I have many questions and concerns regarding EverPower's Cassadaga Wind Project. Why would EverPower use the World Health Organization's 1999 outdated nighttime noise standards of 45 dBAs for their noise design goals with, instead of the WHO's revised and current 2009 40 dBA nighttime recommendations, to which New York State DOA, the Department of Health, subscribes? It's, it makes me wonder, why does EverPower discount subaudible infrasound, its health effects, and its need to be adequately measured, especially inside receptors' homes where it reverberates, where its impact is known to be greatest? Even NYSERDA research has shown that, and they only did one measurement that I can find on their infrasound study at Boutwell Hill, not even near a residence, it was near a camp, and in their barren wind scoping statement response, they said that they don't plan on doing infrasound studies. It's not necessary because it's subaudible. Well, then I would like to point out that at the 2009 NYSERDA meeting, Dr. Dan Driscoll, he's the former noise control engineer for the Public Service Commission, testified that infrasound are the sounds you can't hear, but you can feel. He said they are not blocked by walls of residences and they can very negatively affect the human body, especially after long exposure, which we will have with turbines for 30 years in our town. He said symptoms include headache, nausea, sleeplessness, etc. He recommended setbacks of at least 3,450 feet to help mitigate this. Why should we allow 1,000 feet? Acousticians Pedersen and Mahler found larger turbines produce significantly more infrasound, like ours are going to be huge. Also, EverPower's very own acousticians, George and David Hessler, measured extremely high levels of low-frequency noise and infrasound at the Shirley Wind Farm in Wisconsin. It was declared a public health hazard by the Brown County Department of Health, stating this was a serious issue, so serious it's possibly going to affect the future of the wind industry. No wonder they don't want to measure it. Acoustician Schomer was there. He advised 33.5 decibel noise limits. The Hesslers, EverPower's own acousticians, concluded that low frequency noise and infrasound below the level of hearing, subaudible, needs to be addressed, not dismissed. They also recommend that 39.5 decibel noise limits is a noise design goals to avoid adverse health effects. So why adopt 45 decibel goals for our project or not advise against our town's chosen 50 decibel limit? Why expose us to these adverse health effects? Why state in your scoping statement, I'm talking to EverPower, in your response that annoyance can't be mitigated by setbacks, inferring that annoyance is due to personality traits, placing the blame on the victim. Who wouldn't be annoyed by sleep-depriving noise, vertigo-causing flicker and strobe, and vibrations through one's house and body? Adequate safe setbacks could certainly mitigate these issues. By allowing 1,000-foot setbacks and 50 decibel noise limits, typically one quarter of wind farm neighbors will be annoyed, and that's even confirmed by NYSERDA's Weatherfield wind turbine study that they admitted was very limited, not very well done, but they've still found a lot of sleep deprivation. Subsequent adverse health effects and risk from sleep deprivation include increased cortisol levels, hypertension, cardiovascular disease, obesity, diabetes, immune and cognitive dysfunction. Ironically, these are the very health problems we fought so hard to combat in our nation. And I'm a nurse, and that's what we're, you know, we've been really addressing in the communities at large in our country. The World Health Organization's report, Kripke and all states, reduced sleep is a greater mortality risk than smoking, hypertension, and cardiac disease. Sleep deprivation and annoyance should not be trivialized. They produce very serious health consequences over time. No one should be forced to sleep in their basement, root cellar, tent, or abandon their home to escape turbine vibrations and noise, as is happening in New York State and worldwide. If anybody would like to see some of these testimonies, they're heartbreaking, and it's just got to stop. It's crazy. The WHO recommends 40 decibel noise limits, even lower, 30 decibel limits for low-frequency turbine noise. WHO also states, and this is very concerning, that 50 decibel noise levels, like our towns, are shown to strongly disrupt hormone secretion cycles during sleep. How can we knowingly expose developing infants and children and residents at large to such dangerous sound limits? And this project predicts, like my husband noted, excessive shadow flicker when Ohio won't even certify for 8 hours, or what, Ohio 30 hours, and New Hampshire just adopted more stringent goals of 8 hours of shadow flicker. And how will they, it looks like they're going to mitigate these with the participators by typical gag orders and money compensation instead of looking at their health and curtailing these. They can turn them off and not expose people to this amount of shadow flicker. Realistic mitigation of negative turbine impacts must be achieved in the planning and design stages by adopting adequate protective siting and noise limits. After they're up and spinning, it's too little too late. You can read of the many lawsuits, negative health and property impacts, loss of amenity and abandoned homes at the Hardscrabble, Orangeville, Cohocton, Tug Hill Farms, and other New York towns, just to name a few. Every wind farm town that I've seen has a lot of issues. Even the Howard Wind, I've heard from people from Howard Wind that have been driven crazy. And sadly, we have adopted those same unsafe siting noise parameters. And then the NRO operations, which my husband cited, they've been employed on a limited basis in Vinyl Haven, Maine, and Hardscrabble, New York, and they have not really accomplished their goal. There's still a lot of noise complaints. They haven't worked, so those are very small wind farms, so I have no faith that they would work here. And I would just humbly ask this board, under our new reinstated Article 10, to set a powerful precedent today. Just say no to the continued practice of improper, unsafe industrial wind turbine siting. Reject this project, please. Green energy should promote good health and not destroy it.
Thank you. The next speaker is Edwin Hill.
Good afternoon.
And following Mr. Hill, we'll hear from Fred Keller. Mr. Hill, please use the microphone so everybody can hear.
I will. Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak this evening. As indicated, my name is Ed Hill. I work for the International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, and I work for the International Office. We call that we call it an international office. It's akin to headquarters. I represent members throughout New York, New Jersey, Delaware, and Pennsylvania in construction. And I'm here today to testify in support of the Cassadaga Wind Project. Should the project be approved and move forward, many of our members who live and typically work in the towns and regions of the project will have the opportunity to work near their homes. Not only is this a benefit to those individuals and their families, but also to the towns themselves. The benefits of hiring local workers versus those from another state are significant to those areas hosting the project. The Department of Commerce's Bureau of Economic Analysis estimates that hiring local workers provides nearly twice the benefits to a region's towns as does hiring workers from outside the area. EverPower has agreed, to the extent possible, to use local workers for the Cassadaga project. As another benefit, the IBEW provides highly skilled and professional workforces. Our members complete either 4 or 5 years of training, depending on the type of work that they do, before they reach fully qualified status. The training includes classroom work, computer-based simulation, computer-based work, and on-the-job training, which is provided by experienced craftsmen and craftswomen. They're also responsible and respectful to the town's property owners and other businesses as they are trained to do, and because they live in the areas that they work. These are their towns as well. The project will pay approximately $1 million a year in taxes and host community agreement payments to the towns and create between 6 and 8 full-time jobs to manage and operate the wind farm once it's completed. Additionally, approximately $250 million worth of capital expenditure will be put in place. That, in addition to the full-time jobs and the construction, will infuse millions of dollars to the local communities over the life of the project. While I was waiting for my opportunity to speak, I also did a quick search and wanted to note that there are currently in the United States approximately 48,000 wind turbines in operation. EverPower has committed to do the right thing with this project from a construction standpoint and from a permitting standpoint. They've committed to do the right things to the host communities of the Cassadaga project. Cassadaga, I'm correct. We encourage the Siting Board to approve the project. Thank you.
Thank you. The next speaker is Fred Keller, following Mr. Keller, Judy Phillips.
Up in Arkwright, they're getting a $154 million subsidy for military surplus turbines. There are turbines which can do 40% efficiency. These turbines, and now I'm not talking about your guys up there, are 15% on the best day possible, all right? Now, when you talk about schools getting money and all, you are being bribed with your own money, all right? Where is that $154 million coming from, right? So they're bribing you, saying, oh, our schools are going to be better.
Mr. Keller,
yes.
Please use the microphone.
Okay. All right. So that's my story. All right. Everybody who's talked, please contact us. We need you. All right. We're going all the way with this. All right. All right. And you guys, I like you. All right.
Thank you, sir.
Anybody need information, here it is.
All right, the next speaker is Judy Phillips. I'm following Ms. Phillips, Mark Lawrence. Again, please use the mic.
The proposed Cassadaga Wind Project should not be allowed by the siting board to be considered by itself. Irreversible and permanent impacts will undoubtedly accrue if multiple wind turbine development continues to proceed with our adjoining townships. The invasive construction process and siting of 123 towering industrial wind turbines for multiple facilities to include Cassadaga Wind and the currently locally approved adjacent Arkwright Summit and the Ball Hill Wind projects will have cumulative impacts desecrating many impressive, scenic, and historic rural viewsheds. The massive amount of associated infrastructure to support an array of turbine projects, such as the building of access roads, substations, and transmission lines, represents a major threat to local and migratory wildlife because it can result in extensive habitat fragmentation and provides avenues for invasion of exotic species. Due to watershed locations, there could be injurious effects on water resources from the collective projects. The environmental impact from the proposed Cassadaga Wind Project will be higher given the close proximity to the other wind projects. I respectfully submit.
Thank you. Mark Lawrence, following Mr. Lawrence, Joseph Palmieri.
Good evening. My name is Mark Lawrence, and I'm the business manager of IBEW Local 1249. Local 1249 supports a strong policy for renewable energy in New York, and Local 1249 journeyman linemen have helped to construct and install the wind farms on over 1,000 wind turbines currently operating in the state. We anticipate hundreds of construction jobs resulting from Cassadaga Wind Farm and 6 to 8 full-time well-paying jobs once completed. This project will source labor and materials from the local area to the extent possible and bring millions of dollars into local goods and services purchased over the life of the project and bring a substantial amount of money annually into tax payments and to the HCA, House Community Agreement. In closing, Local 1249 recognizes the state's emphasis on renewable energy as an important part of the overall energy plan. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, the next speaker is Joseph Palmieri, following Mr. Palmieri, Bruce Roll.
Good evening. I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to speak on behalf of the Cassadaga Wind Farm. As a representative of the operating engineers, we fully support these types of projects because it brings works to our members that reside in this area. Jobs that are local, good paying jobs, and bring that revenue into the community. These projects employ over 100 operating engineers over the duration of the project. A lot of these members reside in the area and are friends and neighbors and look forward to these projects such as this to support their families and put food on their table. This is not only good for the operating engineers, but for all the trades as well. The laborers, iron workers, IBEW, you're talking over hundreds of people on this project. EverPower is a leader in the wind farm industry and has done these projects across the country. We look forward to working with them. I have one other comment. I look at these projects just as our forefathers have in the past looked at things. And if it wasn't for the things that they have done, none of us would have the things we enjoy today. We support and work on these types of projects in this area and had great success. We fully support and look forward to be part of this project. Thank you.
Thank you. Bruce Rowland, by Mr. Rowland, William Fiquete. I'm not sure I'm pronouncing that correctly. F-E-K-E-T-E. Mr. Roll.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak. I'm opposed to the construction and public funding of the Arkwright Summit Wind Project, the Cassadaga Wind Project, and the Ball Hill Wind Energy Project in Chautauqua County. I believe that proposing a project of this size, scope, and negative impact shows a total disregard for this area, the environment, wildlife habitat, bird habitat, and the health of the residents of Chautauqua County. This is a naturally beautiful, naturally clean, naturally healthy, naturally safe place to live. A project of this magnitude with massive towers and propeller blades would destroy all of that. It would turn this area into an industrial site that would be neurologically toxic to the residents and all living things through the distortion and disruption of the natural elements, the wind, light, and sound. Constructing massive towers with propeller blades of a height of 1,600 feet and the escarpment would be like draining Chautauqua Lake. There won't be anything left that makes this area what it is. There's a natural balance in this area that is environmentally and ecologically beneficial that can't be bought or created by man and will only be destroyed by this project. What hasn't been damaged or destroyed by agriculture should be preserved and protected. As residents of Arkwright for 26 years, my wife and I have not received any notification of this project, the Arkwright project, from the company, applicant, town of Arkwright, Chautauqua County, or New York State. Apparently, the project was started more than a decade ago, and the notice from the Army Corps of Engineers was the only notice we received last month. It is also my understanding that the Chautauqua County IDA schedules and conducts public forums without the public in attendance. It is my understanding that the IDA schedules and conducts public forums consisting primarily of paid supporters of the project. The town of Arkwright employee informed me that there was a public forum in November 2015 to discuss the Arkwright project with no one in attendance. We were not aware of the meeting. At recent meetings of the town of Hanover town board and Villanova town board, company representatives were present to explain the Ball Hill Wind project. It was with great concern and very troubling to hear that the presenters denied, dismissed, and minimized town residents' questions and concerns about the negative environmental impacts and health hazards to humans that would be created by the project. It is unfortunate that county residents have not been informed of this project are being misinformed by residents of the company. It appears that the only thing green about this project are the public funds used to artificially support it and the money paid to a small number of supporters, these landowners, to create a no-win situation for the rest of us and to destroy the place that we live. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson.
All right, the next speaker is William Fiquette, and following Mr. Fiquette, Michael Byham.
Good evening. My name is William Fiquette. I'm the president of Local 17 of the Operating Engineers, and I'd like to speak on behalf of the Cassadaga Wind Farm. We have many members living in these communities who will welcome a good construction job in their own backyard. We have been involved in these types of projects for years, and the economic benefit is exponential. Projects such as the Cassadaga Wind Farm provide renewable energy and tax base for the community. The economy is also favorably impacted during the construction of these projects. EverPower is committed to utilizing a local labor force, but in addition to the labor force, when you bring 100 construction workers into a small community such as this, local businesses are impacted as well. Hardware stores, restaurants, auto repair centers, gravel pits, suppliers and local contractors will also reap the benefit contributing to the local economy. After the construction, there'll be 6 or 8 permanent jobs with this wind farm, but there's also service work that employs many of my members. I have a half a dozen members currently working in the other wind projects at a time of year when construction work is usually hard to find. Again, I'm in favor of this project.
David Wilkinson. Thank you. Calling Mr. Wilkinson, who you'll hear from. Patty Greenstein.
Hello, my name is David Wilkinson, and I represent the IBEW local construction workers here in Chautauqua County. I've resided in Cassadaga for over 25 years now, so as I've heard people say, I'm not from here. Well, I am from here. And as you know, we struggle in the construction industry from time to time, putting our members to work. There's 175 inside and apprentice wiremen that live in this community that provide tax dollars and also have homes in this community. And we rely on the public and our community to put us to work. And here we are again deciding whether our members go without work and become victims of the state and unemployment agencies. So just a couple of points. It will put our local tradesmen to work, and the work will contribute to the local economy. We'll put probably 100 to 150 people from your community, as EverPower has committed to us, to work locally. Now, I know that it doesn't sound like that's a lot of people, but in a community that struggles for work of any kind or to move this community forward, it is important to us and our survival. We provide our own health care. We provide our own pension plans. We do not rely on the public except to go to work, and that's all our members would like to do. It'll create $2 million annually for local tax dollars, which are desperately needed in this rural community in which I reside, and my 4 children have graduated from this village school. Cassadaga Valley, which I'm very proud of, by the way. The funding for our schools, townships, and other tax dollars that we do gain will help balance our tax levies, which we know are been increasing as our property values continue to decrease, not only from wind turbines, but from just nobody wants to live here anymore because there's no employment opportunities. And I, as the IBEW representative, have always tried to put our members to work. And it's important that the community does so as well. Construction creates revenue to local businesses, not only in goods and services, but localized spending by workers while the project is being conducted. We have been ensured that EverPower will hire local labor as applicable. And finally, a personal comment. I know change is difficult, but we must, as a community and state, pursue alternative opportunities that create revenues that substantiate our rural way of life. Remember, I do live here, I hunt fish, I do all those things that we enjoy around here as well. And as our community diminishes and our tax levies go up and our homes are devalued except by the assessor, these are important projects that will put our people to work and maybe create some money to substantiate our rural lifestyle. It's my opinion as a local resident and as a local labor person that this is an opportunity that we should not overlook. Thank you.
Thank you. The next speaker is Patty Greenstein.
Greenstein.
Thank you.
My second go around.
All right, but just a moment. And then following Ms. Greenstein, we'll hear from Teresa Brettel. All right, thank you.
This is my second go around with the windmill issue in the town of Charlotte. And a lot of the research that I did 5-6 years ago is outdated. But as of the 2010 census, this is a 36.5 square mile, the town of Charlotte, and we now have 612 households. And we're talking about putting industrial turbines in what basically has become a residential area. The whole thing about, I hear people talking about, it's gonna bring in jobs. The research that I've done in the past, and even just, and another thing, I wasn't notified of this either. It took a friend to call me on the phone. There was no notification. Most people don't even know if this is going on. And this is what happened 5 years ago. Everything was done behind closed doors and people weren't even aware that this was going on in their own backyard. So my biggest question is why are we putting 400, 600 foot industrial turbines across the street from somebody's house? Doesn't make any sense. There's all kinds of other people that have quoted the problems with infrasound, blade throw, all this sort of thing that is dangerous to people. The pilot program that they promised to people, you can talk to the people in the town of Eagle, was a huge meeting, and some of you were probably there 5 years ago at BOCES. There were farmers that came up from the town of Eagle. The two men that I remember most specifically, an older fellow said, well, I'm gonna be dead in 10 years anyways. I just want my payment. But there was a younger farmer, about 45 years old, who said, I regret doing this to my neighbors. I regret letting them come in and do this. They dug up some of my best farmland. He lost 25 acres of his best farmland because of an access road and the transmission lines. And on top of it, his neighbor suffered from the decisions that he made. We are a community. I've lived here for 29 years, I think. I don't want to fight with my neighbors, but I also don't want to have these monsters living on top of me. Because the way it stands now in the town of Charlotte, 1,000 feet, is that as long as this building here? That's 1,000 feet. So 1,000 feet from the foundation of my house. Okay, 60 feet. That's whole, if you go all the way to that there, to all the way to the end, 1,000 feet, you put a 600 foot turbine. You are going to have flicker effect. You're gonna have infrasound. You're gonna have disruption of your basic lifestyle. It's gonna happen. After I talked to these farmers, I went up to the town of Eagle with a person who was on the board, and we walked around the whole thing. We spent a whole entire day up there. Talked, and people were afraid to talk because there were gag orders that were placed and people were not allowed to say anything. But I stood underneath these windmills. It depends on where you stand. If you're right below them, you don't hear anything. But if you walk away a couple hundred feet, 1,000 feet, 2,000 feet, depending the way the wind is blowing, you're gonna feel it. It's like that guy from Mass that heard a helicopter. You feel it all the time. And I don't think people are thinking about the long-term effects of it. As far as employment goes, my son's a lineman, okay? He left here because he couldn't get a job here. He found a better job out west. But the whole thing is he did this in school. The wind turbine is 2/3 of the wind turbine industry is subsidized. So basically, we're all paying for it. So if they're giving you, oh, we're giving you a pilot, basically they're just giving back the money that you paid out from the federal government and the state government because the whole thing is subsidized. We're seeing more and more residential windmills. They're maybe 20, 30 feet. The cost per kilowatt hour for them is a better investment for an area like this. But when you start bringing in these wind turbines and you're talking about disruption of everybody's farmland, everybody's view, you're talking about disrupting the watershed, number one. Up in the town of Charlotte, we are the source of the Jamestown watershed. So you start putting in 40 square yards for every turbine, you're talking about disturbing a whole entire watershed that feeds a whole city. And I don't think people are really thinking of the consequences environmentally and to what they're doing to their neighbors. As far as jobs go, I think they're kind of overinflated. There will end up being a few technicians that are maybe paid 20-some dollars an hour at the cost of giving up our safety, our security, and our farmland. So for the farmer, I appreciated the comment from the younger farmer who said he regretted what he had done. Not only did it disrupt him, but it created problems with his neighbors that he regretted. I think we're making a mistake here. Thank you.
Thank you. The next speaker is Fred Brettel. Fred Brettel? Following Mr. Brettel, Jonathan Townsend. Good evening.
I thank you for the opportunity to speak to you tonight. My comments reflect a lot of the things that have been already stated or suggested. I'm all for the scientific research that would go into addressing the health effects that might be caused by shadow flicker, strobe effect, noise, and things of that nature. I'm also very concerned about the environmental problems that would present themselves, such as impact on migrating birds and bats, and possibly even the water quality and the effect on the water table. I am very upset about the fracturing of the community and the effect that we are seeing here tonight, for instance, people against people. This is a very small community, and we've generally been very friendly to each other. And if you don't know each other, you're at least civil to each other. And you get into a situation like tonight, and people are making comments and wishing you would go away and not liking you, and sometimes even expressing hatred and anger. And I feel that is taking away from the quality of life here. So this the mitigating factors, how do you address fracturing the community? It's the human population that we have here tonight. The developer, the company that's promoting this project, being subsidized from the state and federal government to develop this project, they put the carrot out there in front of us. For instance, the pilot programs that are being paid to the municipalities. It's not addressing everyone, because the municipalities, they have control over their township on their roads, for instance, and they can have a positive impact on the infrastructure, such as roads and bridges. But not everybody lives on a town road. Many of us live on a county highway or a state highway, and so those pilot programs don't address those people's benefit. The school district payments is just a carrot. It's to, you know, make it look good that like everybody's going to benefit not everybody has children addressing or going to the schools. So I think that's considered a big carrot, an economic carrot. The lease agreements for the people that are having a windmill or the roads and communication or the distribution lines, they're benefiting from the lease agreement. And I do not feel that they're doing it for everyone's dissatisfaction, but they're benefiting from the lease agreement. And every farmer needs a shot in the armor, and because the it's very tough to be a farmer today with the millions of dollars of debt that they carry, the hard work they do 24/7. So a shot in the arm like that economically is to their benefit, and I don't want to minimize that positive impact. But what about all the other citizens that live in these project areas? Their needs are not being addressed. They're being overlooked, and they're not being satisfied with anything. So are the pilot payments good enough? I don't think so. Is the school district payments good enough? I don't think so. Are the lease agreements for the people, signing lease agreements, are they good enough? Probably not. And how would everyone benefit? Lowering the cost of electricity? Well, what about the family or the individual child that might have ill effect due to the shadow flicker and strobe effect or noise or something? How are those people compensated for their ill effect? And so with all these things in coming to mind, I would like to say that I'm not in favor of this project going forward.
Thank you. Jonathan Townsend, following Mr. Townsend, Robert Gauss.
Thanks, everybody, for giving me the opportunity to speak tonight. As you might expect, I wanted to come out and give a word to the bat species in our area. So 10 years ago, a disease was discovered called white nose syndrome that over the last 10 years has killed upwards of 6 million bats in the northeastern United States. Wind energy is estimated on a conservative basis to kill about 500,000 bats every year in the United States. So since white nose syndrome was discovered, and this is a disease that has been termed the most precipitous decline of wildlife since the passenger pigeon or the American bison. So since white nose syndrome has been discovered, wind energy has killed almost that same number of bats. So what do we call that impact? So I don't want to talk about a lot of the other issues that have been brought up with human health or habitat fragmentation impacts the water quality and scenic view sheds. We really need to focus on how this is going to impact bats. They're slow reproducers. They have maybe one pup per year. So every bat you take out generally means that you are reducing the future population of bats by upwards of 30 individuals. So every bat that is killed by one of these turbines has its place and is very important in preventing that from happening. So based on the memos on EverPower's website, they acknowledge the fact that you can't put a single turbine up in New York State and not kill a bat. When I ask a very specific question about cumulative impacts, they told me to read their five-volume set of data and studies that have been going on. They can't answer very simple questions about these impacts. And I work full-time. I'd love to read through those volumes, but I certainly don't have the time to do that before the meeting today. And I'll be looking into those to see what I might find in there. So I'm here today to testify my opposition to this project. I feel there is no public need for the project. I know there's been a lot of talk about economic incentives to the local area, but this is a footprint of 40,000 acres for 126 megawatts. If we were to do a solar installation, generally you need about 2.5, probably in this area of the country, maybe twice that much for 1 megawatt. So we're looking at maybe 300 or 600 acres of solar panels installed to generate the equivalent electrical output of this 126 megawatt installation. That's like covering maybe 20 miles of I-90 with solar panels. Or why don't we go to a giant parking lot at a shopping center and put up solar panels? Why are we going out and fragmenting habitat? Look at the strife that this project has created in your community.
think about the bats. I know most people probably don't care about the bats, but think about the impacts to wildlife and wetlands and forests that are really getting to a tipping point where we cannot turn back this tide if we go too far forward. So based on the impacts to bat species, hydrology, scenic view sheds, human health, I don't think this project should go forward. I think there's a lot of other better ways that we could be generating this electricity, and eventually this isn't going to be a positive outcome for the local community. So, thank you.
Thank you. Robert Gauss, calling Mr. Gauss, Clyde Rogers.
I'm from the town of Garrett, Bob Gauss.
And I would like the scientific proof that there is a net societal benefit to the use of industrial wind turbines. To an ordinary man, the genius of electrical power is that it's always there, at the flip of a switch. Gas, coal, and water power generators can produce that what is needed when it is needed. Adding sources of power to our grid that are as variable as the wind is a head scratch. Wind turbines that sit idle for days, then produce megawatts, play havoc with our grid. It is not a problem now, as wind power is not significant. But in Germany, where it is in the neighborhood of 35%, it is creating major problems, forcing them to build coal-fired, actually lignite, a soft coal, coal-fired plants to replace the nuclear ones that they took offline. Our unelected officials and politicians are not acting in the best interests of the citizens. Our jobs and our communities depend on reasonably priced energy. Utilities are forced to pay a premium for wind-powered energy, so we end up subsidizing the scheme. It was truly a practical way to produce cheap energy. It would stand on its own. Instead of relying on taxpayers and ratepayers, I'm talking about our Niagara Mohawk, to pay for its inefficiencies and reward corporations for installing these machines. We in Chautauqua County already take in others' garbage, and now we are to scour the landscape with these noisy giants. For what gain? Some landowners will profit. Our politicians can bask in their greenness at a respectable distance. Mm-hmm. And there will be jobs for a short period, bulldozing hills, leveling forests, pouring tons and tons of concrete, and setting towers. I wish they could be put to work building a decent town hall in Gary. Then we are left with these monoliths, and being mechanical, they wear out, and they break down, and at best, they last 25 years. I feel we are being sold a bill of goods. There is no science behind this very impractical method of generating electricity. It is based on an ideology that is being foisted on us by our betters. Thank you.
Thank you. The next speaker is Clyde Rogers, calling Mr. Rogers, Karen Harvey.
Thank you. I am not a polished public speaker. I don't have a lot of facts and figures written down on the paper. I'm going to speak from my experience in the area. The wife and I moved here in the 70s and raised our children here. 39 and a half years ago, we went into the farm equipment business, and we have survived it. But over those periods of time, we got to noticing things were going down, down, down. One evening, about 5 years ago, we sat down and listed 130 plus farms that we used to do business with our small business, that are now out of business. 130. These all had tractors and plows and discs and people that worked there. They're gone. Since we've been here, we have seen Pine Valley school size cut in half, approximately, the number of students. The village and town of Cherry Creek, the number of residents, is approximately half what it was years ago. We are losing a lot of our best students to out of the area because we don't offer good jobs here. Our economy here is terrible. The only thing that seems to be up in this area is government regulations, people living off of the government and taxes. A few years ago, we had the opportunity to have possibly have gas wells. Well, due to a lot of, I'm going to say it, downstate pressure, the gas well thing never happened, and so that is gone. The towers in another that we're looking at now should create some jobs. They are going to help with tax relief for the school and the town, and they are going to eventually create a better business climate. So hopefully we can draw some business back in and have these kids stay around and have good jobs. Now, I'm speaking from some experience with the wind towers. Through our business, I have been to the wind tower farms up in northern New York. I've been to Eagle. I've been to Howard. I've talked to people out there. I've never heard of all these drastic problems that we were shared with tonight, okay? As far as I'm concerned personally, the people of Cherry Creek that I deal with on a regular basis, and I do business with a lot due to our type of business, they have spoken, and they are in favor of the wind project. Our local governments have spoken. The town of Cherry Creek and Shalott, the boards have said, hey, we're in favor of it. As far as I'm concerned, we don't need another recount. We had one of them just recently. We need action and a plan to kind of move ahead. Let's get at it, and using one other gentleman's term, let's make this area great again. Thank you.
Thank you.
As citizens here, we pay for electricity twice, through our monthly electric bill and a second time through the taxes that finance massive subsidies by our government for inefficient wind and other energy producers. Wind is not competitive, it is too expensive, and it is not reliable. These subsidies could better be used to help some of the working people and the farmers in this area for better projects that have end results that are more useful. These subsidies also make the U.S. energy infrastructure more tenuous because the artificially cheap electricity prices push more reliable producers, including those needed as backup, out of the market. As we rely more on wind for our power and its inherent unreliability, the risk of blackouts can occur. Now, another gentleman mentioned Germany. They are presently building 42 new coal-fired plants to back up their wind power because it is unreliable, and their communities are now paying 39 cents a kilowatt hour for their power. It's even higher in England and other countries in Europe. Now, one of the subsidies, one of the companies, first state that at this point in time, 84% of those subsidies, which amount to $30 billion in 2014, are 84% go to companies and investors from foreign countries. Those subsidies come from our taxes and they go out of our country. The transmission lines in this area were an issue in a recent legal case for a company that pops up real quickly. The five top recipients of federal grants and tax credits include NRG Energy, one of our neighbors who very quickly upon buying power in this area reduced its tax contribution because it could, because there was no opposition, because they had eight attorneys and we had only one town attorney. So $40 million disappeared from our community. NRG stopped paying their taxes. Well, now they are the top five in this country, and they, of those top five, receive more federal grants among the other five, $1 billion a year, federal subsidies, because they're going green. Mr. Schumer said they're not good citizens. They did not represent what we needed in this community, providing jobs, providing electricity that was reliable and clean. They were not clean. They were cited by a previous attorney general as the dirtiest company in the state. What did they do? They played us out, they took their money, they collected it, they didn't pay their taxes, and then they closed up shop and left town. The record shows that in California, three companies, major energy companies, I don't have their names, have disappeared. They all received $60 to $100 million in state and federal subsidies. They weren't wind farms. They got their subsidies and they vanished. Because, as someone explained over here, these are investment things. They're held by various companies that have a seven-year cycle that is then reinvested somewhere else. Is that going to happen here? This lawsuit that I mentioned against NRG talked about the transmission lines needing to be upgraded because their efficiencies were so poor that if they upgraded them, they would have 50% more power with nothing but an upgrade of cleaning up and getting the lines that transmit our electricity up to par. For one thing, we're losing almost 50% of power that's produced from Niagara, from coal, from gas, from all the other places. We're losing it, 50% of it. If you put money, investment, subsidies into making them more efficient by upgrading them, they're very old, they're inadequate. Study from the Texas Tech University indicates that it now costs $149 per kilowatt hour. The subsidies are gigantic, and we are paying for them twice. But let me go further and say that Mr. Cuomo is calling for 50% energy from low carbon resources by 2030, at a cost to us, the taxpayers, of $7.6 billion to subsidize this. The government has mandated wind and solar to provide energy that coal and gas-fired plants that provide our electricity. Most of our electricity is coal and gas, but wind and solar cannot replace what coal and gas-fired plants produce, nor can it support industry. Cuomo's reasoning of imposing executive control over the New York energy production is based on the erroneous assumption that carbon dioxide is a pollutant. If you're a farmer, you know carbon dioxide is what plants eat. We breathe out 40,000 parts per million, and plants take it in, and they produce through photosynthesis, they produce the carbohydrates, they produce the food we eat, the potatoes, the rice, the peanuts. Carbon dioxide is not a pollutant, it's the most vital part of our environment. We've been fooled. They're going to tax our breath. The Earth has greened 20% since carbon dioxide has increased from 350 parts per million to 400 parts per million. The more CO2 there is, the more plants, the more fruit, the more wood, and the healthier everything is. Farmers who are in the nature of agribusiness pump 1,200 parts per million into their greenhouses to produce better plants, more vegetables. Makes sense to me. When we produced the coal and the gas that we're now using, that was called the Carboniferous period in ecological terms. Geological terms. The Carboniferous period produced gigantic amounts of plants, which then were turned into coal and oil. Guess what the parts per million of carbon dioxide was? 2,000 parts per million during that period of time. Everything flourished. It was a growing time. It was an evolution time. It's not a pollutant. It is not a pollutant. We have pollution. We have much pollution. We have mercury. We have lead. We have any number of things. We're talking about sound pollution and vibration pollution now, but carbon dioxide is the most essential thing in our entire gas. When you look at the graph of air, you'll see carbon dioxide is 0.04%. Oxygen is gigantic, and nitrogen is gigantic out of 100%. Carbon dioxide is tiny, and it's essential for plants, and if we cut it, plants will not benefit. So I say stop pollution, but don't blame carbon dioxide. It is not a pollutant, and they're basing all these erroneous and harmful projects like wind, which can be great for a local farmer, for small places, but it isn't going to cut it on a larger scale. And when I did attend that open house, I was told When I questioned them, I asked, how long does it take before these break even, before you make a profit, before you get the money that was invested in them? He told me 75% of it is from our taxes initially. How long? He said 15 years before it breaks even. Well, I think Mr. Trump would say that's not viable. That is not sustainable. It's not competitive. And I asked, how long do these things live before they have to be dismantled? If they, who's going to dismantle them? That's another question. He said 25 years. That's not real good economics. So this law that is now taxing us to put these things in place to the tune of $900,000 a year in Chautauqua County, a viable, veritable carbon tax will be put in place on April Fool's Day. Good luck.
Thank you. Roy Harvey. The next speaker is Roy Harvey, following Mr. Harvey, Johnny Yanni. Excuse me, John Yanni.
My name is Roy Harvey. I'm from Mayville. Warren Buffett, whom we all know, who's in the business of wind, says, is quoted to the effect that wind turbine energy wouldn't make any sense, any money, without subsidy. Several people have said that. It's heavily subsidized to the degree of apparently 75%. It wouldn't exist without our money, taxpayer money. In effect, it's not profitable, and in addition to other problems. I'd like to point out what the previous speaker just said. April 1st, this coming year, April Fool's Day, the people of Chautauqua are going to be taxed an additional $900,000. And this is part of Governor Cuomo's essentially executive order that mandates half of New York's energy come from so-called green energy. Well, this may not seem important to you, but this accounts for about $7.6 billion, a program to produce green energy, to reduce our carbon footprint, or stop producing so much CO2. CO2 is not a pollutant, but this whole program is based on the notion that CO2 is a poison, a pollutant. They've even outlawed this thing. Obama has. So rather than debate the many problems with the gigantic wind turbines, or the more important issue to me, I think, for all of us, is the governor's arbitrary program that's based on misguided science of global warming alarmism. Various corporations are reasonably taking advantage of this mandated economic program, or boondoggle, but it will result in more costly energy and an increasingly impoverished public. Thank you.
Thank you. John Yanni?
I'm not going to keep you here any longer or bore you with a whole bunch of statistics. I want to support those people who took the time to research those things and come here with that information, and I'm glad that they did. I've done some research myself, and I found those things that they have spoke of to be true as far as I have researched. But I know one thing that is absolutely true. There has been no transparency in this process from the beginning. Yeah. None. Okay? Absolutely none. I would like to have the people who were responsible for getting the union representatives here tonight put in charge of getting the information out to the residents who are going to be affected by this project. Because they did a hell of a good job. And I'm not saying anything against those people. We need jobs. They're exactly right. I share their concern. But is our government going to give us a choice that you have jobs and poor health? That's a choice? We need better elected representatives. Better elected representatives. And 4 or 5 years down the road, these old boys over here will be gone.
Yep.
Okay? And we'll be left, those of us who put our hard-earned money into our homes and property, will be left holding the bag with something we can't get rid of. Shame on our government.
Thank you. All right. That concludes all the statements from people who have asked to speak. Is there, please, by a show of hands, let me know if there's anybody else present who hasn't spoken who wishes to make a statement. Are you Ms. Brettel?
Yes.
All right. Teresa Brettel?
My name is Teresa, and I didn't come prepared with anything, but
just a moment. After all right, so the next speaker is Teresa Brettel.
Okay, Teresa.
Go ahead.
Thank you. After listening to what everyone here had to say, I try to come to this meeting with an open mind and look at both sides of the company, as well as the community, as well as those benefiting from these wind towers on the property. And to me, it seems like the jobs that may be created, the economy that may be pumped, may be temporary compared to the long-lasting negative side effects that may become of what we may suffer from. I've lived here 35 years, moved out to the country because I love the serenity, the peace and quiet, and all the benefits nature has to offer. But more importantly is the silence that really helps me as an individual. I'm very concerned about the noise and the decibels and the infrasound. I'm an avid gardener, hiker, cross-country skier, enjoy seeing everybody out hunting, snowmobiling. That will all be affected. Okay, I don't care what you say, because each tower is affected by 28 acres, am I right? Around it, okay, 28 acres per tower. There's gonna be guy wires, everything else around that tower. So you multiply that.
There are no guy wires.
There's no guy wires. Okay, well, whatever it is, there's going to be about 28 acres around each wind tower that you can't go under or are restricted from. There's no distance at all.
No, farmers farm right under
it. They can farm right under it?
Yeah, they can.
And we don't have to worry about anything falling off the blades?
My point is,
I'm sure there's all kinds of negative side effects. The point being is, for the little bit of generated energy that there will be, that's going to be green, it seems like it's not enough to put forth a positive green form of energy with all the side effects that I see. And the few jobs that may come of it, are we willing to sacrifice our health and our environment for that? I'm not. I want to know one other thing. If this happens in about 3 years, which I want to retire and sell my home, if I can't sell my home for what it's appraised for now, say within a 5%, and it's going to be not sellable, is EverPower going to buy my home? Who's going to buy my house? I'm counting on moving somewhere else, and if I can't sell my home, I guess I'm stuck. And how am I benefiting? You said earlier in the meeting, everybody's going to benefit from this. Name one thing that I'm going to benefit. Is my electricity going to be reduced? No. Will I have free electric? No. My tax base? Hardly. Maybe about 1%. It's not worth it to me. I'm looking to move out of here because of that. And I bet I won't be able to sell my house in 3 years. But I hate to move because I love this area. It has wonderful things to offer. And you're going to affect something that's going to be permanent forever. And I want to know, too. It's a question, but I know you can't answer it. In 25 years, who's going to remove these monsters once that energy is superseded by something even better? Okay, it might be obsolete in 5 years, and are you willing to remove that? I'm sure there's something in your book that says you will, but if you're gone, you know, we're gonna be stuck with a bag like the other guy mentioned. Okay, I don't feel it's a good thing. And I'm asking that it be really researched by everyone who really thinks it is a good thing. Really do your homework and do your research like all these people that did, that came up here and spoke. They looked at studies, and they looked at what's been done everywhere else in the world. So I'm just asking you to reconsider. Thank you.
Thank you very much. All right, that concludes the public statements. Before I close the record, I want to remind you that the public statement hearing notice advertising this meeting tonight describes how to submit comments during the pendency of the case. And as I mentioned earlier, a procedural conference will be held here tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. You're welcome to come and observe, but participation in the procedural conference is limited to the parties in the case. But I'll mention additionally that you can sign on to become a party at the Siting Board's website if you wish to do that. It would mean that you participate more actively in the case. So with that being said, I want to thank you for your attendance tonight, ladies and gentlemen, and wish you a safe journey home.
Thank you.